then. Here you go. Okay, go. Oh, I have to look at that.
Will you give me a thumbs up then? We're ready. Good morning. Welcome to First Christian Church. Great pleasure to have all of you with us today. Thank you, Joanne, for the prelude. We look forward to hearing from you all morning. She's filling in as Robert's on somewhere down south, I think. A couple things to note here as we get going. Welcome to a new month of November. Say goodbye to daylight savings time for a while. Your new newsletters for the month are over here where they're usually come in, if you need to pick one of those up. I want to give a big welcome today to visitors we have with us and everyone watching at home. We're so glad you're all here with us today. Our projects for November, Rock Solid Ministries is filling Thanksgiving baskets, and we're going to help provide them with a bunch of items. They're asking for canned vegetables and fruit, boxed mac and cheese, boxed dressing, canned sweet potatoes, rolls, powdered drinks, and you can get a selection of those items on our trees, see what you want to bring. The free will offering will also benefit that food basket project. I believe I need to call on Cindy.
I'll do this formally. Good morning, church. Welcome to all of you at home, because I'm talking to all of you at home and here. I don't know about you, but I keep a pretty close watch on the COVID numbers for Indiana, but also for Wayne County. And the numbers that are in Wayne County alone are disturbing. I've heard that there have been up to 30 people a day have been going to read. And so we are in a time of concern. I'm not going to say crisis, but it may be there. What I want you to know, this is not a church that disparages people who do not feel safe coming to church. If you feel safe watching from home, I know everyone prefers to be in church, I know that. But if you feel safer being at home, go home. Stay home and worship with us via the technology. It's not the best of the world, but I'd rather have you there and comfortable and safe than here. Now, I do applaud that all of you and all, since we've been doing this, people wear their masks. They sit apart, and that's good. But with the numbers soaring the way they are, I'm concerned. If it gets down to me and two other people, we'll need a musician, and we need to run all that back there. And I'm talking the soundboard, the computer for this, and the camera. Theoretically, that can be done by one person, maybe two people. If that's the only people in the room, fine. We will still do our worship. If there are people here who do not have access to Facebook or internet and you want to come, then come. We want you here. Because you can. If there's only two or three people here, you're going to be safe here. But I want everyone to feel comfortable making the decision. If you feel safer at home, then go home, okay? I do not want anyone to say, well, I was looked down upon because I worship from home. That ain't here. That's not this church. This church is one of grace and love, and we want you to be comfortable. We want you to be safe above all, okay? Now let's turn our prayers to God. Are we done? Oh, we got to pray. We got to say hi to everybody.
Well, I do want to ask if anybody else has any important news or any announcements we need to hear about. I don't see anybody rushing up or waving a hand, so let's stand and greet one another remotely.
Hi, everybody. Hi, Doug. Hugs. Hugs to you all. Hugs to you at home. Let us praise God in music. Joanne, take it away. It is a time to go to the one who set all the mountains in their place and brought the flowers and the skies. It is a time to praise God, and it is a time to take to God, the one who controls it all, the one who's over us all, the one who loves us all, and take to God all our joys and our concerns. A couple weeks ago, I mentioned that a friend of mine's mother was in hospice, and then the next week I announced that she had passed. Well, I got word this week that her husband's mother is now in hospice. So this is a hard time for this family, and this family has been through some tragedy in their past. So they are people of faith, and so we ask the Stone Messer family in our prayers as they deal with oncoming death. Adriana has a friend who's like a mother to her, who is fighting for her life in a hospital. So let us keep Adriana's friend in our prayers and Adriana. It's hard to lose those people. We all have those. They're not, maybe not blood family, but they are family of our heart, and they mean as much to us as anybody else. So Adriana, you'll be in our prayers, as will your friend. In 2 days, this nation will go to the polls, those who haven't already been to the polls, for election night and the nights that follow. It's going to be an interesting week. It could be, there's some worry to it, there's some anxiety to it, but let us pray for our nation that we can handle whatever happens with grace and love and brotherhood. We also, as I mentioned earlier, that we are in a COVID spike in this county and in this state, as many places in the nation, and that gives us concern. So we ask for grace upon all those who are suffering, the businesses that are now worried they're going to have to shut down again. Let us keep all the COVID issues in our prayers, that we can withstand it, again with grace and a spirit of community, loving community. But you know, amidst all those concerns, there are joys. Ruth and I were out planting flowers yesterday. And planting flowers just does something nice. It reminds you that spring is on the other side of winter, and there will be beautiful flowers. And we saw trick-or-treaters, and there's such joy and laughter in those trick-or-treaters. How many had trick-or-treaters last night? Yeah. I mean, aren't they cute? You know, I heard we had a little Thomas the Train action going on with Tristan. And we had a scary clown over here who's here this morning. And that's okay. This is joy. This is life. And so even amidst all the concerns in our life, God still allows us to have some laughter and some joy. Let us take it all to the one who loves us best and knows us best. Let us pray. Most holy God, you who have put the sky above us and called it beautiful and good, you have put the earth below us and have called it good. You call light and darkness good. You call plants and animals of all kinds good. You created humans of all varieties, and you call them not only good, but beloved. Lord God, we thank you for the many graces and blessings that you give to us. Air to breathe and life to enjoy. Families that make us laugh. And even in sorrow, Lord, we remember that where there is sorrow, there has been love, and love is always a good thing. Help us to maintain that love even in difficult times, just as your love for us has been maintained even when we cause you difficulties. Help us to be as steadfast as possible as you are. Glorious God, we lift up all those who are hurting today. Hurting because of death is on the horizon or possibly on the horizon, and we're frightened to lose people we love. Be with Adriana and her friend. Be with Wendy and Bill and their watch over Mary Lou. Lord, we ask you to be with all those in our world who are suffering these times of uncertainty. We can call them holy, but they are still painful. Give grace and comfort to all those who need. Lord, we ask you to be with those who are suffering the onspike, the upward swing of COVID-19. Those who are ill, those who are taking care of them in the hospital, those who have loved ones who are suffering, those who have businesses that are small businesses, now on the brink of possibly another shutdown, businesses that might be lost, income that is lost, so much uncertainty and fear and hurt and anger. Help us show grace, Lord. Keep them strong and keep them comfortable and keep them healthy. And help us do what we need to do to help them. Lord, we ask you also to accept our gratitude for a nation that allows us the privilege and the right and the honor to choose our leaders. Help us to respect the decisions made by our fellow citizens as they go to the polls and push a button or mark a ballot or pull a lever. This is a priceless gift of this country, Lord, and we thank you for it. Help us to remain as citizens of one country, despite our differences in mindsets and politics, despite our differences in ethnicities and concerns. Help us to react to whatever happens with grace and loving community, bowing to work within the system to help this country grow strong, whatever happens this week. And Lord, we thank you for the joys you give us, the joys of flowers, even though we don't see them yet, even though they have been buried deep into the dirt. We know that come warmer weather and your sun, there will be flowers, reminding us that in death there is life, and that is beautiful. Holy God, hear all our prayers that we offer up to you to now as we pray as your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. For the last 2 weeks, we have talked about faithful preparation for what's next. So that we can handle what's next with a confidence born of our faith. We did this last week by pledging financial support so that we could do whatever ministries we're called to do in 2021. And for that, for your generosity, I am thankful to you. You showed great generosity, and we still need some to come in, so we're looking forward to those pledge cards to come in. But right now, I thank you for your generosity. Now, in truth, I did not intend to carry on this what's next beyond last week. My plan was just to move on and tell part of the story of Daniel. But the more I was looking at Daniel to prepare for today, the more I saw just how relevant Daniel's story is to us here in the 21st century. And especially as we go through the final days of a rather aggressive political campaign season. Now, the lessons found in Daniel can help teach us how to handle whatever's next. Now, the book of Daniel isn't often used as a basis for Sunday sermons in Christian churches. Christians tend to know only a couple of stories about the book. One, three guys are thrown into a fire, and then Daniel shows up where? In a lion's den, and gets out. Both the three men and Daniel escaped those turmoils without unscathed because of their faith. We know those stories of Daniel. But that's about it. But there's a lot more to this wonderful book. Now, Hebrew tradition places the book of Daniel among the writings of the Hebrew Bible. Remember that the Hebrew Bible is often referred to as the Tanakh. T-N-K. If you remember T-N-K, that's what the Hebrew Bible tends to be known as. It has three sections, T-N-K. The Torah, the first five books of the Bible, the five books of Moses. Torah means teaching and law. It is the most sacred portion of the Hebrew Bible to the Jews. The second section is the Nevi'im, or the prophets. And these include some of the history of the Jewish people. The third section of the Tanakh is the Ketuvim, or the writings. And these writings provide wisdom and lessons of faith for us. The book of Daniel is part of the faith lessons in the Ketuvim, the third section of the Tanakh. Now, Daniel has a lot to teach us about working and serving in a political climate that runs counter to our personal beliefs. Each of us has to admit today that however the upcoming election turns out, some of us will find ourselves having to live and work and serve in a political climate that runs counter to our personal beliefs. Just a fact of life. The question becomes, how do we do that? Daniel shows us how. And let me tell you, name-calling and hate and denigrating the humanity of the other side, whichever side is the other side to you, ain't it. Now, before I read our scripture passage this morning, let me give you a brief backstory on this story about our boy Daniel. The book begins with King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon attacking and conquering Jerusalem. His army destroys the glorious Temple of Solomon. Thus begins the first major Jerusalem Jewish exile. The prophet Jeremiah referred to King Nebuchadnezzar as the destroyer of nations. King Nebuchadnezzar also forced some of the best and brightest of Israel's young men to live in Babylon, and they were educated in all branches of wisdom and literature and language, all to serve the whims, whatever, of the king, this Babylonian king who had destroyed their country. Daniel was one of those young men. From the beginning, Daniel served the king, but he did so with discretion. He maintained primary faithfulness toward the one true God, his God. He served the king. He did what he was asked, so long as it did not run counter to the supreme authority of God. At the beginning of chapter 2 in the book of Daniel, the king repeatedly has had a disturbing dream. And the mystery of the dream so troubled him that he can't sleep anymore. So he calls his counselors together and he says, "Tell me what I dreamed and then interpret it for me. And if you don't, I'm going to kill you. And I'll ransack your homes." "Well, they might be able to interpret, my friends, but I can't tell you what you dream until you tell me what you dreamed." But they couldn't. And the king was enraged. He commanded them to be destroyed. But just before they were to be executed, our hero Daniel steps up and says, "Give me some time and I'll get the information for you." Now we come to Daniel 2, verses 17 through 23, our scripture for this morning. "Then Daniel went to his home and informed his companions, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and told them to seek mercy from God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that Daniel and his companions with the rest of the wise men of Babylon might not perish. Then the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a wisdom of the night, in a vision of the night, and Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel said, 'Blessed be the name of God from age to age, for wisdom and power are his. He changes times and season, deposes kings and sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. To you, O God of my ancestors, I give thanks and praise. Will you pray with me? Holy God, open our eyes, our ears, our hearts, and our minds to your word this day and every day. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You know, too often I think that we like to look at the past and reminisce about how faithful the world was. We tell ourselves that there was a time in our culture when it was truly godly. We think that back then political leaders were all honorable men and women. And I do not deny for one moment that in every generation there were people and there were times when we were in tune with God's will. But let's not kid ourselves. Our culture in the past, in those wonderful years we remember with such fondness, also had quite a bit of problems. Many of these problems arose when our leaders, locally and nationally, did not act particularly godly. And they certainly did not act according to the teachings of Jesus Christ. Way too often, we didn't love our neighbor as ourselves. And we didn't love each other as Christ loved us. That's two of the three commandments. And if you're violating those two, you're probably not loving God as well. Instead, we restricted where people could sit for lunch or where they could sit on a bus. And people who tried to sit elsewhere were met with violence and even were arrested. We withheld hospitality in a community or even a congregation because of that person's ethnicity or family origin or their gender or how they choose to live their life. We kept citizens from exercising their precious right to vote, and when they tried, they were abused. All problems in our way to recent past, in our lifetimes. Some of these problems are still with us today. The question again is, how do people of faith whose lives are committed to Jesus Christ live and serve within such a culture? This is a situation in the book of Daniel. Daniel was a man living in a time when his people had been conquered, Jerusalem had been destroyed, the Holy Temple was in ruins. Daniel was forced to live in a land not his own, serve a king that was not his own. He was forced to serve this king and this kingdom who did not recognize the one true God. And you just know that Daniel could not have been happy living in a culture that was so contrary to God's ways. Contrary to the God of Abraham, the one true God. As a man of faith, it had to disturb Daniel deeply. But what's he to do? What we see in the book of Daniel is a man who, despite the culture around him, maintained his integrity of faith and his commitment to God. In our scripture passage this morning, we see Daniel's reverence to God. But before Daniel made a request of God, he sought mercy from God. He then praised the wonder and glory of God. You see, Daniel understood at his core that although the king he served may have been powerful, God was more powerful. God was grander. God was more magnificent. And so when push came to shove, in Daniel's work and in his life, God's way prevailed. And so Daniel worked according to God's commandments. He loved God. He loved his neighbors. Even though he may not have agreed with them, he loved them. He did not act out in violence. Rather, he worked with humility and honor and integrity. When he was asked to do things or even eat things that were contrary to his beliefs, Daniel found a way around it. And when he couldn't find a way around it, he stood ready to accept the consequences. Living his faith was simply more important to him than living according to this king he served. And In serving like this, people in Babylon began to notice. Even the king eventually came to have an understanding about the supremacy of the God of Abraham, but the one that Daniel worshipped. Now, trust me, I stand here a proud American. I love that America gives us the right to speak out against what we believe is wrong. We have freedom of speech, and I love that out about this country. I love that we get to work within the political system to bring about changes we believe need to be made. I love the constitutional framework that protects all our freedoms, regardless of which political party or which candidate you support. But above my life as an American, I am a believer in God. I am a servant and a disciple of Jesus Christ. In our day-to-day lives and employment, we see people do ordinary things that they ordinarily disagree with. When I was a kid, it was doing dishes. I didn't like doing dishes, because I'd rather not. I'd rather watch TV, go play. When I clerked at a store, it may have been something as mundane as where to put a stack of groceries. But that's the manager's decision, not mine. When I was a lawyer, it may have been which cases to take or not take. The decision wasn't always mine. There are higher-ups I had to obey. Now, nothing ungodly in any of these circumstances. It's just not how you would do things if you had control of a situation. But you obey those in authority over you, because this is a commonplace fact of life whenever you work for someone else. And even if you are self-employed, whether you have your own business, there are things you do you'd rather not do because government, taxes, what have you. Sometimes we do what we don't want to do. I was also privileged to work with many honorable people of faith in the government and in private business. These were good and willing, honorable workers. They worked long hours. They gave up weekends doing work that needed to be done. They served the best they could because of their work ethic, because it's who they were. Even if they disagreed with what was being done, it didn't go against their faith. They did it anyway, and they sacrificed for it. But I also saw these good and honorable people refuse to do work that ran contrary to their understanding of God's laws. Maybe they were asked to work on Sunday or some holy day, and they refused. Maybe they were asked to cut some corner, just a smidge dishonest, not much, and they refused. Maybe they were asked to handle a case where God's authority ran contrary, and they refused. They did so because God was more important to them than the earthly authority governing them at that moment. Most times, their refusal resulted in no difficulties to them. There may have even been people who appreciated and respected the integrity of their faith. Sometimes, however, these people of faith met with consequences. Maybe they lost their job because they refused to do something. Or even if they didn't lose their job, people looked at them with contempt, because they're not team players. To these people of faith, however, it simply did not matter. Their faith and their commitment to God was of primary importance, and God was what controlled their life. Sometime this week, or near future, we will know something about the next 4 years in our country. Some of us will be pleased. Some of us will be worried. Some of us will be scared. Some of us may even be furious or angry. Regardless of your feelings about any outcome of this week's election, I urge you to be a Daniel. Be faithful to the one whom I pray is supreme in your heart and over your life. Because that is not president, that is not a senator, that is not a congressman, nor anyone of any political office holder. What should be supreme in your heart and your life is God. Because as Daniel taught us, wisdom and power are God's. God changes times and seasons, deposes kings and sets up kings. God gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. God reveals deep and hidden things. God knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with God. To you, O God of my ancestors, we give thanks and praise. Amen. Being a Christian does not mean things come easily to us, but we worship a larger power. It's key to me. Hebrew National Hot Dogs. How many remember Hebrew National Hot Dogs? Hebrew National Hot Dogs used to have this commercial that they didn't put pork or odd things in their hot dogs because their hot dogs were kosher. And we answer to a higher authority. I've always loved that. It was my first understanding of kosher, what it means to be kosher. Sometimes, as people of faith, not sometimes, all times, we answer to a higher authority. We do what we do. We do with our job. Even if we disagree with what the boss is asking us to do, we do it. Because we do it in humility and we do it with grace. But we walk with a higher power. If you want to make a confession of faith to that higher power right now, then now's a great time to do it. If you're at home, you want to make a confession of faith, call me, email me. Our phone number and our email address is on the Facebook page. And I will happily meet with you to talk about what it means to be a person of faith, to be a Christian, one who's made a confession of faith to Christ. For the rest of us, those of us who've made a confession of faith, but you want to join this church, come forward. And we will talk about your reaffirmation of your faith here. Again, for you at home, give me a call. If you want to make this your home, whether it's online or here, call me, email me, and we will happily talk. It is time for all of us to re-evaluate our connection to the one we say is Lord of our life. Because that might mean we have consequences, that we have sacrifices. I want to lash out at this person who won that election. Or lash out at this person because they didn't win the election. But our time as Daniels, as people of Christ, we know that we cannot lash out. We act with grace and we act with love because we're loving our neighbors. Let us stand and recommit ourselves to our Lord.
Of one who walks beside us and this myself. Good morning. When I was preparing for today, for the moment of ministry, I thought, well, I better look up the meaning of offering. And that's defined as the act of making an offer, a gift, or a contribution. So the word offer has many other uses, but the very first definition was offer, to present to God in an act of worship. So there are many ways to make an offering to God financially and personally. You and I are offerings in our actions to the church, to our families, to our friends, and to strangers. And we as a church offer ourselves to others by bringing donations to support the church and to support the many service projects of the Gifts of Love Trees every month and by the money in the jars in the pews. Gifts we give to honor God in our community. And as your treasurer, I'm pleased at your response to the pledges for 2021. But we haven't met budget yet, so please respond. Mail your pledges into the Post Office Box 216, zip code 47375, or bring it to the church anytime, Monday through Thursday, 8:30 to 2:30. Today, if you brought your offerings for today, they go, of course, in the plates at the exits and at the end of the pews. So thank you very much for your support, for supporting the community as well.
When Ruth was up here talking, there was a different words up there. It was called Moment for Ministry. It's often up there when we do our offering. Now we have a different picture of a different kind of offering that we remember every time we come to this table. Over here, we talk about giving of our lives, giving of our time, our talent, and our treasures so that this church can do ministries in the coming year or now. The offering that we remember at this table allows us new life, allows us to be one with God, to be reconciled to the creator of the universe because of the one that made the offering that we remember here. We remember that Christ made an offering of himself, of his blood, of his body, of his mind, of his gifts, of his time. He walked all over telling of God's love for people, that God loved them so much that there's nothing that can distance you from God. Only you can do that, because God stands there ready to bring you home. The offering that Christ made on this planet and on a cross is what we remember here. Let us take a few moments to remember that great offering.
Dear God, you call us as we are and forgive all that we've done. We thank you for the assurance of your forgiveness. We thank you for the symbols of the bread and cup that remind us of Jesus and how much he gave to make your forgiveness known to us. As we take the bread and the cup, let us commit ourselves to lifting burdens for others and sharing your freely given love with all we meet. It is in your name that we live and pray. Amen.
At that table of offering, Christ took ordinary bread. Nothing magical about the bread. It was simple bread from a simple feast with his friends and followers. And he gave thanks to God for that bread, and he blessed the bread, and he broke the bread, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." At the end of the meal, Christ took the cup of salvation, and he says, "This is my blood shed for you, each of you. Drink this in remembrance of me." One of the blessings I get to do when I'm sitting up here is I get to watch you guys have communion. It is a beautiful sight. It is a beautiful sight for you as single individuals sitting there in your pews communing with your God, which is my God too. I just wanted to say that. That's a beautiful sight. Let's have some music. this week, if you feel the urge to be angry, to be anxious, to gloat, to be hateful, remember you are a person of God. And God tells us to love all. And loving people do not gloat, they do not hate, and they don't speak out in anger. They love. They tolerate. They cherish each and every human being, regardless of whether we understand them or regardless of whether we agree with their position. This week, I want you to remember you are Daniel. Have a great week. Remember, God loves you. So do I. Have a great week. Bye-bye. Bye, everybody.